Abby got the PhD degree in Penn State University. Then I think she moved to the University of Washington mm-hmm. to work with Mark Bamshad. Mm-hmm. And later went to University of Michigan as an assistant professor, and I think that's where she is right now. And she has been working for many, many years in the genetic basis of adaptation to altitude. And this is the topic of the lecture today.
Yeah.
So yes, whenever you want.
Thanks, Esteban. I wanted to say thank you for showing up and for inviting me here today. This is my second time in Toronto, and it's a great city and a great university, so it's nice to be back, particularly in the fall. I was here in the winter before, it was a bit colder, although Michigan's not much different. So I'm going to be talking about my work at altitude and sort of this pursuit of going from identifying genomic signatures of selection to linking them up with phenotypes, and then now getting into trying to link that genetic change to understanding the functional consequence of that on phenotype, besides just statistical association, or I should say beyond. When humans migrated out of Africa and they migrated around the world, right, we basically inhabit all parts of the globe, whether or not we would have considered them inhabitable or not from the get-go. And if we look at global habitat diversity, we see that there is a large range. Even I always like to point out Madagascar. For example, even on Madagascar, you see this wide variation of habitat diversity, which means that there's going to be responses, adaptation, adaptability, right, both via natural selection and also just short-term adaptation to different environmental differences. So you can think of things like climate, things like temperature, humidity, solar radiation, and then also what I'm going to focus on today, altitude. And how, if we look across all of these habitats, regardless of where we are, the air that we breathe is the same. It's 21% oxygen, and mostly nitrogen, a little bit of carbon dioxide, and some argon. So the air itself maintains constant. But as you go into these high altitude regions, you experience what's called hypoxia. And it's caused by a decrease in barometric pressure. So here I'm showing you just a schematic of as you increase in altitude with meters indicated on the left, your pressure decreases. So the air molecules themselves go from being condensed and packed tight to becoming more and more diffuse. So the amount of oxygen in every breath and in the air is the same, but the total content of oxygen is more diffuse. So there's less oxygen to actually bring into your system. And 2,500 meters here is indicated because that is the altitude at which we say high altitude begins. And the reason for 2,500 meters is it's where we actually see, if you look at what's called a hemoglobin oxygen dissociation curve, it's where you start to see the physiological effects of low ambient oxygen tension on physiology. So 2,500 meters is usually the cutoff. And so, not to overemphasize this, right? We get it. Oxygen decreases with increasing altitude. But just to put some perspective on it with regards to places that we might be familiar with, so this is a three-part graph. We have barometric pressure and inspired oxygen, and then we have altitude there along the x-axis. And so, you have Everest juxtaposed against sea level, and as you move from sea level to Everest, barometric pressure declines and inspired oxygen plummets. And Denver and Pikes Peak are on there for reference. Denver's always called, the Mile High City, and you hear people talking about, when sports teams have to play the Denver Broncos, they're always out of breath. But in fact, Denver's not high altitude. It's below 2,000 meters. And so the altitudes that I'm going to be talking about today are actually, in fact, much greater than that. So there are three regions of human high altitude adaptation. The first is the Tibetan Plateau, and the earliest occupation is roughly estimated around 25,000 years ago. And all of these dates that I'm going to be talking to you about today are rooted in archaeology. The second locale is the Andean Altiplano, and earliest human occupation there is estimated around 11,000 years ago. And the third locale is the Simian Plateau, which most people are usually, when they think of places where humans have lived at altitude for millennia, they think of Tibetan Plateau and the Andean Altiplano. But the Simian Plateau is also a place where people have adapted to altitude. It is the youngest of the three with respect to human occupation, and human occupation there dates to around 8,000 years ago. And so if we go back here to this image that I showed you before, and we put on La Paz, Bolivia, Cusco, Peru, and Lhasa, Tibet, we see where they fall on this schematic of barometric pressure and inspired oxygen. So they have, if compared to sea level, right, they're, versus barometric pressure being about 800, it drops to about 500, and that has an impact on how much oxygen is available to the organism. And if we just representing it a little bit of a different way, the Altiplano is right about here at about 12,000 feet, and on the Altiplano we have roughly 64% of the oxygen that would be available at sea level. So that's in fact a pretty significant difference in the amount of oxygen available, and it's what we're interested in is understanding how that impacts physiology and if those impacts to physiology have genetic ramifications. So my question is, how do high altitude populations physiologically overcome this low ambient oxygen tension? And so a few things motivate this research. So we'd like to identify the genetic mechanisms that are responsible for producing the high altitude phenotypes. We also want to contrast the Andean and Tibetan adaptations, because they're different, and I'm going to talk us through those in a bit, to establish whether or not convergent or parallel adaptation has occurred in these two populations. We also want to integrate both evolutionary and functional approaches so that we can critically understand the molecular mechanisms that are involved in these genetic changes. So let me just compare Andean and Tibetans physiologically for a few slides to sort of set the stage so that we understand how their basic biology is different. So I'm not going to be talking about genetics, I'm just going to be talking about observable physiological phenotypes that have been studied for decades. And so all of these images I'm going to show you are from the work of others from previous publications. So Tibetans have higher resting ventilation. So that means when they are at rest, as you are in the room, they breathe more. That's if you think about one way to get more oxygen into your system, it's to have a higher respiratory rate. And this image here is from a paper by Cynthia Bell from 1997. there's a lot going on with all of these shapes, right? It's definitely not a 2016 image. But what the take-home message is, so the filled circles and the filled squares, the filled circles and the filled triangles are Tibetan females and Tibetan males, and their resting ventilation rate is at the highest peak right of this graph. And then we have altitude along the x-axis. So as you move from sea level up to a little over 5,000 meters, your resting ventilation, we see an increase, but we see the greatest increase among Tibetan highlanders. And those are averages across the sample. If we turn to the Andes, we see that Andeans exhibit a blunted or low ventilatory response. So if we were to go to high altitude right now, so say we were all going to go skiing, right? We're going to fly to Calgary and then go to, or maybe we'll go to Wisp, or at, not Wisp. Whistler. Thank you. Wisp is a little tiny ski resort near where I grew up in Pennsylvania. totally different. We would all respond by hyperventilating, essentially. Our nervous system would cause our body to actually breathe more rapidly. Andeans, when challenged, so Andeans are, they live at altitude. They have lived at altitude for millennia. But if you are someone who lives on the Altiplano, let's say you live in Cusco, it's roughly 3,600 meters, right? Say you move from Cusco to the place where I've done my work in Cerro de Pasco, which is 4,300 meters. It's quite a big difference. Andeans will have a blunted ventilatory response. So they won't have this increase in ventilation that we would see among Tibetans who actually do have a ventilatory response when they're challenged by increasing altitudes. And we, of course, we as non-adapted lowland dwellers have this response as well. Tibetans, they have a blunted hematopoietic response to altitude. So hemoglobin, right, is the molecule that carries oxygen throughout your body. So we would think one way to overcome this low oxygen is to simply have more hemoglobin. If you have more hemoglobin, you have more oxygen circulating in your system. Interestingly, if you look at the Tibetan data, Tibetans actually have lower hemoglobin than, so here we have Tibetan males and females in blue and Andean males and females in yellow. We distinguish males and females because males and females have different hemoglobin concentrations because we have different iron loads and women experience menstruation, which influences hemoglobin levels in the long run. So we see sex effects on hemoglobin. But if you'll notice, the Tibetan hemoglobin is significantly less than Andean hemoglobin. And furthermore, it's also less than sea level natives when we go to high altitude. So they're actually lowering their hemoglobin. So to many, that may seem very counterintuitive. Why would you decrease the amount of hemoglobin you have in your body? Well, when you increase hemoglobin, your blood becomes more viscous. And it actually is, in fact, more difficult to get through your circulatory system. So the argument has been made that, in fact, lowering your hemoglobin can actually deliver more oxygen to your bodily tissues because it can get there more quickly. And the second, the bottom portion of this graph is showing oxygen saturation. And if we compare Tibetan and Andeans at the equivalent altitudes, Andeans have higher resting arterial oxygen saturation. So that means there's more oxygen bound to hemoglobin. So you can have more hemoglobin, or maybe you could just have more oxygen bound to that hemoglobin. And we see that Andeans have high resting arterial oxygen saturation with comparison to Tibetans, and they also would, of course, in comparison to any one of us in the room if we traveled to high altitude. So this is, if any of you have ever gone in for just routine medical care, when they put the pulse ox on your finger and they measure your arterial oxygen saturation, usually it's right 100 or 99%. When I go to altitude, my resting arterial sats plummet to about 72. So Andeans and Tibetans maintain arterial oxygen saturations. Tibetans in the low 90s, upper 80s, and Andeans in the right around the mid 90s. So quite a big difference in comparison to low altitude persons. And then lastly, I want to just talk a bit about birth weight decline. So here we have Tibetans and Sherpas and Andeans. So we have two high altitude populations on the top. And we have European and Han Chinese, two low altitude populations on the bottom. And both of these groups are included because they have migrated to high altitude for various reasons. So Han Chinese have moved to Lhasa, Tibet. And these European women are from La Paz, Bolivia, as the capital of Bolivia. And the point is that if you look at Tibetan and Andean birth weight decline, so we're starting out at zero and moving up to a little over, just under 5,000 meters, birth weight declines with altitude for all four of these populations presented, but the birth weight decline seen among high altitude groups is significantly less than the birth weight decline that we see with low altitude natives. And I'm not going to talk much about this birth weight decline today in my talk, but this is something that I have published on in the past, and I've collaborated with a woman at UC Denver by the name of Lorna Moore, who actually put together these data. And so if you're interested in that, I'm happy to talk a bit about it after the talk. And so just to summarize everything I've just walked through, Andeans and Tibetans exhibit distinct physiological adaptations. So we see they have different pathways for overcoming this low ambient oxygen tension. Some of the phenotypes, the ones that I talked about, are resting ventilation, hypoxic ventilatory response, arterial oxygen saturation, hemoglobin concentration, and birth weight. And so we want to ask then, what is the genetic basis for these observed physiological changes? And there is data suggesting that there is genetic control over these physiological adaptations. So for example, another collaborator of mine, and in fact Esteban's, has shown that Native American ancestry proportion, so the proportion of an individual's continental ancestry that's attributed to the Americas, is associated with that hypoxic ventilatory response. So we see that that's an indication, right, that there could be something genetic going on. We also see that Native American ancestry proportion is associated with birth weight. And I also have uterine artery diameter. One of Lorna Moore's study did a lot of imaging during pregnancy, looking at blood flow to the developing fetus through the placenta. And they looked at measures of uterine artery and other arterial measures. But uterine artery in particular was greater in Andean women. And it looks as though this is at week 20 of 20 weeks of pregnancy, uterine artery diameter and percentage of Native American ancestry is associated, suggesting that there is a genetic component driving this oxygen delivery to the developing fetus. So quick summary, Andeans and Tibetans exhibit distinct physiological adaptations, and we also see that ancestry is associated with several high altitude phenotypes. So do Andean and Tibetan genomes exhibit evidence of positive directional selection for genetic adaptation to altitude? And if so, are the patterns of genetic adaptation distinct? So to answer this question, we've set out many years ago with a cohort that was comprised of high altitude study participants, 49 individuals from Tibet, and 49 individuals from the Altiplano. 24 were Quechua from Peru, and 25 were Aymara from Bolivia. And we contrasted their genomes to low altitude comparison populations. We used the HapMap, publicly available data, CEF Europeans, Japanese, Han Chinese. And then we also looked at individuals from Mexico of Maya and Mixtec, Tlapanec, and Nahua speakers from Coastal Guerrero. And we genotyped them on the Affymetrix SNP array that roughly has a million markers spread throughout the genome. And then we interrogated the data with a barrage of statistical tests that are super common among population geneticists. And so I'm not going to go into the details of what the tests actually were, like what LSBL is, but I want to give you the general message of what the data told us upon our analysis. So here's one statistic that we can use, which is called the locus-specific branch length. And just really quickly, I'm just going to show you what it does is it isolates change in one population compared to two other populations. So for example, if we had a genetic locus that was genotyped in Mesoamericans, East Asians, and Andeans, we'd be interested in identifying SNPs that were typed on this array that were very different in Andeans compared to the two population comparisons, Mesoamericans and East Asians, because it would indicate that there was genetic change occurring. Whether or not that's due to natural selection or genetic drift is to be determined, but we know that a genetic change has occurred. Why that genetic change has occurred is you know, unknown. But we can use tools to identify ones that we do think are likely candidates of natural selection. So if we take all of these data, these 1 million SNPs, and we calculate the statistic for it. And then we look at these branch lengths among Andeans, Mesoamericans, and East Asians. LSBL can range from 0 to 1, which is why you're seeing the x-axis here going from 0 to 1. And then I'm showing you the number of SNPs that each fall into each bin. So we would be interested in this tail of the distribution, that 5% tail, that empirical statistical significance, or maybe the 1%. So I'm just showing you a blow up here of the LSBL with SNPs that you can't really discern well because of the size of the SNPs in this bin all the way on the left. So we would consider those statistically significant. And we did the same thing with Tibetans, comparing Tibetans to Europeans and East Asians and identifying SNPs in the tail. And so, of course, when you do this, LSBL is shown up on the top, and then there are several other statistics we applied, LNRH to GMSD and a haplotype test. I'm grouping them by Andeans and Tibetans. This table doesn't really tell you anything other than the fact that we found tens of thousands of significant results using this method. So, right, it ends up being one of these things. Where is it? How can we discern from all of these data what really is significant and meaningful? And so we came up with ways to tease through these data. And one approach that we did, so here I'm showing you locus-specific branch length across the length of chromosome 12. And any peak you see that's red is indicated as significant according to this 5% empirical distribution, and anything you see that's blue is not significant according to this 5% empirical distribution. And we basically did a sliding window approach where we grouped the results as we moved across the chromosome. And when we did this for three of our statistics, and here I'm showing you chromosome 12 along the bottom, right here is the centromere, we see, and I think it should just jump out at you regardless if you know what LNRH or LSBL or Tajima's D, what those actually are, you see this region on chromosome 12 that has this density of red significant peaks or valleys, depending on which way the statistic is reading. And if we apply this hypergeometric distribution using a hypergeometric method for basically taking the heuristic of just looking at it and actually applying a statistical significance to it, this region was significant at, you know, highly significant at p less than 0.004, indicating that this is a region that is highly likely to have changed in Andeans, and potentially not just by drift, because it's such a big region with so many statistically significant results. And so this is a region on chromosome 12 that we don't really have any a priori reason for thinking that's involved in oxygen sensing. There's no genes in that region that actually are involved in pathways that involve oxygen respiration or etc. And so this is just a summary. So we were able to take, and I don't want to scroll back, but we were able to take all of those results and sort of winnow it down to actually, I think it's like 42 regions that across the genome that we could focus on. And we did the same thing and this is that chromosome 12 region that I was telling you about. So you see that it's not only is there one region, but they're stacked based on the sizes that we chose to look at. And if we do the same with Tibetans, we actually have fewer regions. But the interesting thing about Tibetans is this one of the top regions that has one of the highest p-values encompasses a gene known as EPAS1. And EPAS1 is part of the hypoxia-inducible transcription factor pathway, or HIF for short. And HIF regulates a broad range of metabolic, respiratory, erythropoietic responses to oxygen concentration at organismal and cellular levels. It's an evolutionary ancient system. This is not, you know, we see it in many organisms. And it plays a fundamental role when we shift from aerobic to anaerobic metabolism. And it does so by upregulating glycolysis and downregulating oxidative phosphorylation. And so when there's a decrease in oxygen tension, this leads to an increase in HIF levels. And that permits HIF1, basically the master regulator, so to speak, to continually target downstream genes to maintain cellular oxygen homeostasis. So HIF and then a cascade of other genes maintains oxygen homeostasis in your system. So we also wanted to look specifically at HIF genes. And so we did this by, I'm actually going to scroll, just do this a little bit more quickly. We compared, and this is again for LSBL, I'm just sticking with LSBL for the sake of consistency. Here we have another empirical distribution for Andeans and Tibetans. The 5% significance level is the dashed line, the 1% significance level is the solid line. And we looked only at HIF genes this time, as opposed to the whole genome. And we identified HIF loci that fell in these empirically statistically significant regions of the genome in Tibetans and Andeans, respectively. And the interesting thing that came out, right, so here's EPAS1 that I was just telling you about in Tibetans. So there are five genes in Andeans, five genes in Tibetans. That's just coincidence that there's five and five. And one gene overlapped, Eglin1. So what does Eglin1 do? So I'm actually just going to skip to the next one. So Eglin1, if we look at it, we see, I do want to tell you this, sorry. So if we look at the HIF pathway, PHD2 is another name for Eglin1 that's commonly used by molecular biologists, and I pulled this image from a molecular biology paper by Frank Lee. So here we have PHD2. And what happens with PHD2 is in normoxia, it continually targets HIF1, that master regulator of the HIF system, for degradation, or to maintain cellular oxygen homeostasis. But in hypoxia, this is blocked, essentially. And so if we look, then if we turn to our genomic data, our SNP data, and we look at the variation that's present in Andeans versus Tibetans, I'm showing you just each square is essentially a polymorphism. The ancestral allele is colored red. The derived allele is colored gray. For the one site where we didn't know the ancestral or derived status, it's an unknown. It's filled in with a bit darker gray. We see the general pattern, right, is rather similar, and we get to this region. And we see differences between the Andean and Tibetan allele frequencies. So this haplotype in Andeans is at roughly 42%, and this haplotype in Tibetans is at roughly 62%. And there were two polymorphisms, this polymorphism here in Tibetans and this polymorphism here in Andeans, that showed the highest LSBL values for each of those populations, respectively, for this region. So I'm just highlighting those. So we were interested in expanding on this SNP data. So we went ahead and we DNA sequenced Eglin1 in both Andeans and Tibetans. And we focused on the exonic regions. There's only five in Eglin1, along with the 3' and 5' UTRs. And here I'm showing you the approximate locations of the SNPs that we identified from the sequencing effort. We sequenced 48 and 48. 48 Tibetans, 48 Andeans. And if I were to show you the data themselves, here are all the SNPs we identified. Some are novel, some are most are known. I'm showing you their RSID, their location, the alleles that are present, the function, their minor allele frequency in Andeans, in Andeans, minor allele frequency in Andeans, Mexicans from the 1000 Genomes Project, Tibetans and East Asians who are HapMap East Asians. And if we look at Tibetan Eglin-1 sequence variation, there are two SNPs that fall in exon 1 that are missense mutations that have very high frequency in Tibetans, but lower, much lower frequency in East Asians, or somewhat lower in East Asians. And if we plot them onto a schematic of Eglin-1, and this is just showing you the messenger RNA, so the introns have been removed, we see this D4E SNP here. It's located upstream of the zinc finger, and then we have the C127S SNP. And what we have learned is that the D4E and the C127S SNPs together, we propose that they're hypomorphic alleles. And so Tibetans display augmented HIF activation to facilitate adaptation to high altitude. And so here in normoxia, we have low altitude inhabitants, and we have our PHD2, aka Eglin-1, and we have P23 and the co-chaperone HSP90 that bind to PHD2 that allow it to continuously target HIF alpha for downstream production of various proteins. And now if we turn over here to hypoxia, among low altitude inhabitants who are at high altitude, this is maintained, this system that's present at low altitude. But if we look at Tibetans, P23 and HSP90 are unable to bind to Eglin-1 because of changes that we think are the result of polymorphisms at D4E and C127S. So it in fact changes, right, and the arrows are showing you how much those downstream genes are targeted. So it down-regulates Eglin-1, resulting in a difference in production in HIF-1 alpha versus HIF-2 alpha. So these data suggest that it's, like I said, it's a hypomorphic allele or a down-regulated allele. Now, if we look at Andean sequence variation, there was one polymorphism from these data that showed the largest allele frequency difference. So it's this RS185 SNP that's intronic. And we did a luciferase assay. We were talking about this before. And not only was, so we have our samples here, our AA genotypes versus our TT that we did in replicate, and R stands for the ranilla control. Our ranilla control had more luciferase activity than either of our homozygous alleles for this particular SNP. So, nada, which we replicated several times. And so the data suggests that it's unlikely that the potentially functional variant of the Andean allele affects the coding sequence or splicing or transcription, because we sequenced these regions and we only identified one SNP that was quite different. And then with our one functional assay, we didn't see any difference in reporter activity. So there was a paper published that did whole genome sequencing on a cohort of chronic mountain sickness patients. So chronic mountain sickness is a complex phenotype that individuals of Andean ancestry experience as they age. And one of the characteristics of it is that your hemoglobin concentration goes beyond what your body can handle. And then they also whole genome sequenced a control cohort that was not CMS. So I took those non-CMS, non-chronic mountain sick, so healthy controls, the data that was published, and I looked at those data around Eglin-1 to see if there were polymorphisms that we didn't capture with our Sanger sequencing. And I'm showing you just a snippet of some of the variation here on this slide that we found. But there is an interesting, so all I'm showing you here are the alleles that had minor allele frequency differences between Andeans and Mexicans that were above an arbitrary threshold, actually, admittedly. And then we took those SNPs and we went into the UCSC genome browser and compared it to the ENCODE data. And I'm highlighting two SNPs in red. So the RS479200 and the RS480902. And these two SNPs reside in regions characterized by H3K27AC marks, DNase1 hypersensitivity, and ChIP-seq transcription factor binding sites. So these were intriguing to us because potentially there's something going on at these SNPs because they might involve a change in regulation of the gene. So maybe it's a regulatory change. So, interesting. So how do we figure out whether or not these SNPs actually are involved in Andean adaptation? Well, and Esteban was involved in this project. So myself and my collaborator, Tom Brutzart, went back to Peru to recruit new study participants to see if we could, and I sort of set this up in a little bit of a strange way. We didn't get these data and then say, let's go to Peru. That's not really the way it all transpired at all. But nonetheless, participant recruitment for trying to understand Andean adaptive phenotypes. Our two study sites are Lima, Peru at 0 meters, and Cerro de Pasco at 4,300 meters. Now, most people, when they think about Peru and the Altiplano, have these visions of places like Machu Picchu, and its stunning glory. And I joked with you earlier about where this project is on the Altiplano. And so where I work in Peru is characterized by a very large open pit mine, which once mined silver, but now it's mostly rare earth metals because the silver has been long ago extracted and basically funded the Spanish colonial project for a couple hundred years. So all the romantic views of field work in high altitude Peru you don't really have with respect to this project. But nonetheless, Cerro de Pasco is it has a special place in my heart, regardless of its lead poisoning and all of the awful things that come along with it. So we have a migrant study design where we have Quechua who are born at sea level. So they're second generation down migrants to Lima, Peru. We have Quechua who migrated to sea level sometime in their lifetime. So they were exposed to high altitude for the developmental period, and then they moved to low altitude after that developmental period. We have Quechua who are multi-generational residents of high altitude of Cerro de Pasco. And we also recruited non-Hispanic Europeans at Syracuse University. Tom Brutzart is a faculty member at Syracuse. And the sample sizes for each are shown below. So I'll just turn the question to you. What's the point of the migrant study designs? I don't know. I feel like I'm just up here talking to such a small group of people. I want to engage you a little bit more. Any thoughts? I don't know. It's useful because with respect to high altitude, we can tease apart this developmental from this genetic component. So if you're born and raised at high altitude, even if I were to move to high altitude tomorrow and to have children there, those children's physiology would be different than mine, even if they had no Andean ancestry, because they were exposed to hypoxia during this developmental period of time. So that's what this does. It disentangles this genetic component from this developmental component. And we spent two summers in Cerro de Pasco, and the Lima recruitment pretty much took place over the rest of the year and it took about 2.5 years to recruit all the Lima participants. Largely because in Lima, you can imagine there are far fewer Quechua residents than Quechua residents in Cerro de Pasco, which is a high altitude community. And they have to travel farther to come to the actual study site, et cetera. And so here's just a few images of our field work. Here's Tom looking at, I was telling you before about that hypoxic ventilatory response. So that's what this is showing you here. It's an individual who's actually being challenged by hypoxia. So we are able to use with gas chambers, you can see one over there in the back, we can simulate altitude at any altitude, and so they're breathing in air that is actually at a higher elevation than the air that's ambient. This is the lab, blood extraction, and I have an individual. This is the phenotype I'm going to focus on in this last little bit of my talk. This is exercise testing to understand both arterial oxygen saturation as well as maximal oxygen consumption during exercise. And this I show this Quechua gentleman because he had the highest VO2 max of that field season. And we told him that. We were blown away with his VO2 max, and that he wasn't the last study participant, right? But we were like, whoa, you know, this is like amazing. And he was really jazzed. And that's his jazzed response for having such a high VO2 max. We collected other phenotypes. We collected hemoglobin just with the HemoQ. Arterial oxygen saturation, VO2 max, forced vital capacity, so lung volume measurements, and hypoxic ventilatory response, plus basic anthropometry, height, weight, body mass, BMI. If we genotyped those two SNPs that we identified from the whole genome sequencing data in this cohort, and you remember that Eglin 1 showed functional variation and in Tibetans, and it's linked to hemoglobin concentration. If we look at these two SNPs in this cohort with hemoglobin, we see here are the Peruvians from this cohort. Here are the Europeans from this cohort, and then we also genotyped them in a cohort of Mexican Maya that were part of fieldwork that I did in Chiapas 2 summers ago. And I'm just showing you the genotype frequencies. The genotype frequencies are, in fact, different, where you have at both of these SNPs, the A allele is at high frequency for the 480902 in comparison to the Europeans, and intermediate in the Mexicans, and that's actually that's interesting. We were encouraged. And then you see the pattern here for the second SNP, the CC genotype. The C allele is at higher frequency compared to Europeans and intermediate and Mexicans. But when we tested for associations with hemoglobin, I mean, this is showing you no significance whatsoever. So then we have data for this cohort from the Affymetrix biobanking array. And actually, this is the array we chose actually in consultation with you, Esteban. And we just pulled out the SNPs that are around this Eglin 1 gene. And there are 33 that are within Eglin 1 and then 50 kb upstream or downstream. And this is just there's not any big take-home message from this part of the slide. I'm showing you dbSNP RSID, whether or not that SNP was polymorphic in our sample, and SNPs that had a minor allele frequency of greater than 1. And over here on the left-hand side, I'm just walking you through this in Word. So we started with 33, 16 were monomorphic, so we eliminated them from our data. Of the remaining, 4 had minor allele frequencies of less than 1, so we didn't want to analyze those. So we had 13 SNPs that we looked for associations with. And I just want to take one step. Oh, and so, sorry. And I'm going to focus on this particular polymorphism for the last few slides, this RS1769793. I always feel so silly just saying these RSIDs out loud. I almost wish I should come up with a different naming convention just for talks instead of reading out numbers. So for many altitude adaptive traits, and this comes back to the study design and why it's so key to success, is that evidence suggests both developmental and genetic origins to explain trait variants. I just want to remind you of this. And I don't really think I need to spend too much time on either of these two slides, but either of these two graphs, but this is a graph showing you genetic data. This is how we measure work. So this is when an individual is on an ergonomic cycler, they're going through different stages, and you increase the intensity of the workload by basically causing greater friction to be applied to the tire. So if you put more friction on, it's harder to pedal. So you have workloads going from 0, which is rest, up to work 1, 2, 3, 4, et cetera. And as the individual moves through work, they start to consume more oxygen, and then eventually they get to their maximal oxygen consumption level. And this is So this is just showing you the take-home message from this is, here we have Aymara, and here we have Europeans born and raised at altitude, so developmental effect has been erased, but the genetic effect is there. You see that Aymara have, this is arterial oxygen saturation, have higher arterial oxygen saturation than Europeans born and raised at the same altitude. So that's indicating a genetic component. This is from, this is a work that Tom Brutzhart did, I think actually, as part of his PhD thesis. And then we also see a developmental component. So here we have Quechua individuals who are born at altitude in the blue, and Quechua individuals who are born at sea level in red. This is another way, so instead of writing out work one, work two, here we have rest, and then here we have 60 watts of work, and we have 90 watts of work, essentially work one and work two. And again, arterial oxygen saturation is along the y-axis. And we see that if you're born at high altitude, you have higher arterial oxygen saturation than if you're born at sea level, even though you have the same ancestry. So there's a developmental effect as well. And Melissa Kiyamu, who worked in Tom Brutzhart's group as a graduate student, and she is Peruvian, she designed this pretty phenomenal study where she recruited Quechua individuals who lived in Lima who were born at sea level, and then Quechua residents who lived in Lima who were born at high altitude. And they actually trained with her. They cardio trained with her. And she measured VO2 max over a period of time. And so these are just images. And so if you see this, I like this image because this is a giant weather balloon that you would normally, meteorologists would use, that she took and she filled with, in Lima, she filled with nitrogen, essentially, to get the air in that balloon to be what it is at Cerro de Pasco. So the individuals didn't have to be taken to altitude to understand the effects of altitude. Rather, they breathed altitude air out of this giant weather balloon, which I think is pretty amazing. And I'm very impressed by the work that she's done. I don't know why those want to animate, but they do. Okay. What she found is that participants that were born and raised at altitude have approximately 10% the maximum oxygen consumption as individuals who were born at sea level. And that's what this graph is showing you. We break it out into males and females. Males born at sea level are shown in blue. So individuals born at sea level, male and female, are shown in blue, and individuals born at altitude are shown in red. VO2 max is along the side, and we see that they're significantly different, both males and females, in their VO2 max between those two places that they were born. So again, developmental effect. And then we took our 13 markers to look to see if we could identify a genetic effect on VO2 max. And this RS ID that I called your attention to explains 2% of the variation in the relative aerobic capacity at altitude. And here I'm showing you males. I'm showing you VO2 max along the y-axis. And here are our four study groups, born sea level, Lima, Quechua born in Lima, Quechua who are born at high altitude and migrated to sea level, individuals, Quechua residents of Cerro de Pasco, and then Syracuse over here on the right. I'm breaking out each of the genotypes at this locus, TT, TC, or CC, and the sample size for each of these genotype categories is shown as the numbers within the bars on the graph. And what we see is that individuals who have the T allele, regardless of their ancestry, have higher mean VO2 max than individuals that have the C allele. And we also see that you might be able to discern that there is this developmental effect that right coming through when you look at this portion of the bar graph, because you have the individuals who are born and raised at high altitude and live at high altitude having higher VO2 maxes than individuals of the other two categories. Now, the Syracuse sample, I want to just take 1 second to tell you something important about it. Tom is at an exercise physiology department. As an outcome of that, a lot of the folks that ended up being participating from Syracuse were in the exercise physiology department. So they in fact are very fit individuals. So when we compare these European data to low altitude Quechua residents, we have a training regimen that is reflected in the fact that their VO2 maxes are a bit higher than what you would have expected compared to someone who is not really into fitness. So I think I just want to make that clear. And then here I'm showing it to you for females. And actually the effect is more pronounced in females and Europeans because of this fitness effect. So that's the caveat to the data. But again, the general trend shows. So we're actually really pretty excited about these results because up until the past couple months, we have really been trying to look for a link between genetic data and phenotypic outcome of high altitude adaptive phenotypes. And I have to tell you, I've struggled with it for several years, coming up empty-handed, looking at associations of genotypes and phenotypes, and nothing has come about it. And to look at VO2 max, to start thinking through this as a potential means in which high altitude Andeans have adapted is pretty exciting. And this is just showing you the statistical model. And there is a sex group interaction, so group being which of those four groups you belong to and your sex, and right, that you would expect that, right, based on these two, the Syracuse female-male comparison. And I think we think that it's that Syracuse component that's actually really driving that sex group interaction term. And this model here is not showing you, so we have, just sort of quickly, I'm not quite out of time, I haven't gone 50 minutes yet, but just to take a quick side note, I don't have a slide showing you this, but we did also, we have the Affymetrix biobanking array data, so one of the things we're concerned with in association studies is population structure in a population. If you have population structure in a population, it could actually be driving the associations that you're seeing just because of cryptic variation that's not known and not, therefore not controlled for. This model here is in fact not showing you the control for population structure, which we did by including the first five PCs from a PCA analysis. Regardless if that's included or not in the model, the effects remain the same. And this is a slide that Tom Brutzart constructed to sort of think through these ideas about how how changes in this gene potentially impact variation at the VO2 max phenotype. So far, what we have is genetic variation explains 2% of the variance, and it's highly significant. And it, right, on VO2 max. And there are other things that are influencing VO2 max. Body size, the group effects, so what are you, migrant, are you born at sea level, born in high altitude, the sex of the individual, and also developmental effects of being born and raised at altitude. So the hypothesis that we're working with is that genetic variation, in order to affect VO2 max, has to have some intermediates. So lung size, the diffusion capacity, our working hypothesis is that genetic variation actually works on lung size, which affects your arterial oxygen saturation, which then impacts this ultimate phenotype of VO2 max. And when we run a model where we include, so here's model one, which is what I showed you before, that does not have forced vital capacity or lung size included, right? We have our significance here and our partial ETA squared here. If we include forced vital capacity in the model, you'll notice actually we lose a little bit of significance, but we've added a cofactor, right? But our partial ETA squared drops down, and FVC is also significant. So that, we're starting to try to understand the pathway that's involved in VO2 max, and by incorporating lung size, it seems as though that may be, we're getting an indication that that's involved. So, to summarize, Tibetan Eglin 1 contributes to hemoglobin phenotype, and decrease in activity of Tibetan Eglin 1 indicates that it might be a loss of functional allele. Andean eglin 1 contributes to VO2 max phenotype, possibly through the effects on lung function, although at this point in time, we don't know if it's a hypermorphic or a hypomorphic allele to affect the regulation of this gene. And so our future work, or ongoing work, is to functionally characterize eglin 1 to determine if it is this loss of function or gain of function allele that ultimately affects lung phenotypes at high altitude. So we're continuing, in the phenotype slide, I talked about several phenotypes, many phenotypes actually, that we collected from our study participants. So we're continuing to explore other genotype-phenotype associations because it's a very rich data set. And we also have some serum samples, but we have plans to go back to Peru this coming summer and reconsent individuals to provide serum samples so that we can look at expression of various SNPs, the SNP that we see the association with, but also I haven't completely abandoned the original two SNPs that we identified from that whole genome sequencing data. So we're still pursuing those, even though we don't know necessarily if they're involved in a phenotype. But we do want to see if there's a change in expression. And then I'm also collaborating with Frank Lee, who did all of the work to identify the Tibetan hypomorphic allele, to use CRISPR technology to introduce the Andean alleles from these two SNPs to characterize interactions with transcription factors. And with that, I'd like to thank all of you. Thank you for coming. And the participants who have so graciously volunteered over the years for this research, as well as our collaborators, particularly Tom Broussard and Frank Lee, who none of this work would be possible without, and then funding. Thanks.
Thank you.
Questions?
Questions?
Yeah.
So first of all, I think this is fascinating for someone who works in Peru, obviously, and both at the highlands of the Andes and also the coast. This is amazing. I guess something I'm really interested in is looking at how rapid, in a generational timeline, genetic versus developmental, so adaptations mm-hmm. can happen.
Mm-hmm.
And I know you brought up earlier effects prenatally. Mm-hmm. Can you comment more about that as to what kind of genetic versus developmental
yeah.
effects would happen?
Yeah. So one component of the research that I haven't talked about at all in this slide is that we are looking at epigenetic effects of
right.
being born and raised at high altitudes using this exact same cohort. And actually, I don't have her name up here because I didn't include any of the work, but I have a graduate student, Ainash Childabayeva, who's looking particularly at that. And so to comment on it's an active area of investigation.
Right.
But even if we weren't doing that, so if you look at methylation, in utero. What happens is, so there's a point in time in utero when methylation marks are erased and then they're placed back on once, early on in development. So it's that uterine phase of development of the fetus where that's taking place. If we have if epigenetics are actually what's contributing to these developmental effects, it's very early on in the developmental process that we're thinking because of this erasure of methylation marks and then this replacement of methylation in the developmental environment. So if it's the hypoxic environment in this case.
But at the time being, you wouldn't be able to say conclusively that there is an epigenetic effect.
No, so what we have done is we have looked at, there's a global methylation marker called a line one element.
Okay.
And we've done line one assays on this cohort, and we see a difference in individuals who were born and raised at high altitude. The most extreme difference is Quechua multi-generational residents of high altitude versus Quechua who are born and raised at low altitude. There's a significant difference in their global methylation. So individuals of Andean descent who live at high altitude have greater amount of methylation. There's a caveat to this, though. You remember I showed you the large open pit mine and I mentioned something about lead.
Yeah.
Cerro de Pasco has one of the highest lead contamination problems in the world. And lead also is known to increase methylation. So now what we're actually doing is we're trying to tease apart the methylation from lead, versus the methylation from altitude. And there are ways that we are able to do this with publicly available data from Cerro de Pasco that has taken soil samples, lead soil samples, and we've used, Ainash went to Peru actually this past summer, went back to Cerro de Pasco, and received, she basically had to get a really good map. So we have that, we know the locations of where all the individuals reside. And also she needed to go and, without physically being there, she couldn't actually map on those residents because there's no street, it just doesn't work that way. You have to be there and you have to figure it out. So we're using proxies for it with these soil-based measures. And then we also, and there are problems with this, but fortuitously, we actually had a blood sample from the collection phase of the project saved in Lima in the freezer, and we've sent it all for lead analysis. So we can get a snapshot of current lead in the body. But what you would really want is lead in the developmental phase, and the only way you can get that is really from bone or from teeth, and so sort of out of the question.
So your idea then is, in different areas with different loads of pollution with lead, no? Mm-hmm. You want to disentangle the
differences. Yes, Esteban, thank you. That's exactly what we want to do. Yeah, so if there is a lead effect, we should be able to see it by variation across the sample in Cerro de Pasco.
Yeah, exactly.
Uh-huh. So that's the hope that we will discern that. Another option is to start another study site.
Yeah.
Right? So, yeah, Malcolm.
So I'm wondering about what role admixture would play, and if I'm not sure if Quechua, if the people there, have there been much admixture with European, like, colonial?
Yeah, so there has been admixture. Mm-hmm. One of the reasons why Cerro de Pasco is the locale that high altitude researchers have focused on for as long as they have. So in the 70s, a university in Lima set up a research station in Cerro de Pasco, Cayetano. And the reason for that is because Cerro de Pasco historically has some, well, maybe that's not the reason why they established it there. It's actually like the direct bus route up from Lima. But one of the reasons it works really well for our research is that the admixture levels from this port, from this particular municipality, are some of the lowest in all of the Altiplano. If you go to Cusco, those admixture rates are going to be much higher. And admixture is a confounder. More European ancestry you have, it's going to affect the phenotypes that are being measured, and it's also going to affect the underlying genomic structure. And it's also why I didn't show a slide, but it's also why we controlled for population structure in our analysis, because that European admixture will have an effect. And I also didn't mention this. I think this is sort of interesting from an anthropological perspective. We also ran it, we recruited roughly 600 Quechua participants over 3 years. And one thing when you're doing field work like this, one of the concerns is always, are you recruiting relatives? We pay our participants. I mean, they're with us for about 5 hours, so we pay them for their time, essentially, as you would for a study that would be conducted here. And so when you have a financial motivation behind participating, that's even potentially increases the likelihood that you might have familial. And so Melissa Kiamu, who I mentioned when I was talking about the developmental effects, she was very, very good at interviewing the potential participants to try to make sure that we weren't collecting individuals who are related, but related individuals can influence the results too, right? You have.
Yeah, but I think if you use a macro array like the biobank,
so we did. We did, and we identified. We did a King analysis, and I can't remember the exact numbers. But if you were to look at my slides a little bit more closely, you would notice that the numbers that we recruited were not the numbers that I actually showed you VO2 max data for. It's because we removed individuals who were related. We removed individuals who actually didn't reach a true VO2 max. That was all Tom's work. And so I feel like there's lots of confounders that can contribute.
With the trying to tease apart lead markers of epigenetic sources, you obviously couldn't get a physiological effects of this, but I come at it from the bioarchaeological side. If you actually went to skeletal remains prior to the lead mine,
Uh-huh.
Would you be able to
well, that's interesting.
Using apart
yeah.
some of those questions? You're also then sampling bones, so you're looking at developmentally
yeah.
formed.
Yeah. No, so interestingly enough, that same student is working with Tiffany Tung, who works at high altitude on, do you know Tiffany Tung?
No,
okay, so she's an Andean archaeologist and who has access to skeletal remains. And one of the things that we're interested in is ancient epigenomics. And I know she's actually going to pursue that a little bit in her dissertation to get at that very question. But at this point in time, I mean, yes, I think that will be fruitful. But
is it possible to really,
look at methylation?
Yeah.
So
retrieve the methylation mark.
That's a good, I mean, so Deborah Bolnick's group at UT has had some success with looking at methylation markers in archaeological material, actually from the Andes. So we're hopeful. I don't think it's any guarantee.
So obviously you have a big data set that you're working with already, but just out of curiosity, has anyone in your project ever considered using as a new data set the Andean Cordillera, and specifically, speaking to that because of the archaeological record showing that for thousands of years you're talking about populations who have seasonally moved back and forth from
yes.
the coastal and
yes.
kind of region, what effect that might have genetically and
no, I'm glad you brought that up because that's something that I've been thinking about for a long time, particularly with like Inca Mita systems and
right,
moving
course,
everybody
yeah.
around and all the vertical tiering that takes place from the Altiplano down to the Amazon. I mean, even today, and you know, Quechua will do Yama trains down into the Amazonian basin and then bring them back up. I mean, we have this ethnographic data that as combined with archaeological data that shows that people are not stationary on the Altiplano. I mean, it's a resource-depleted region. You have to go lower to get the foodstuffs that you need beyond quinoa and potatoes. So I think that potentially has had an effect. I struggle with exactly how to incorporate that into my understanding, like what effect that has had on adaptation there. Because it's not as though there's another group, it's not as though there's other populations on the Altiplano who we know have never moved, right? I mean, it's a natural experiment design that has caveats.
I guess it'd be interesting to see if there is an elevation gradient that forms if you were to subsample the section.
Yeah.
Or maybe not.
Yeah, no, and I think that's, there have been, even at lower elevations, we see, outside of the Altiplano, we see the impact of changes in oxygen tension on genomes. At least that's the data suggest. So I would expect it to be there, and I think that's a good idea. Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe because so many migrations, then the genetic effect
gets lowered. Yeah.
So I have a silly question possibly about the physiological and phenotypic experiments. When you're trying to simulate the high altitude environment,
mm-hmm.
is there other factors such as UV radiation or temperature that could be playing a role and so these experiments aren't actually capturing that?
Yeah, so we actually take a little weather, we have humidity, barometric pressure, all of those things are recorded at the time of study
mm-hmm.
because we need to incorporate them into some of the models that we use for some of the phenotypes. So yes,
okay.
absolutely, those things. UV radiation is not something that we incorporate into the phenotypes that we're looking at, but in fact, skin pigmentation
mm-hmm.
at altitude is an open-ended
mm-hmm.
research question that nobody, in fact, has really explored. We would expect folks from the Altiplano to have more deeply pigmented skin than individuals from surrounding areas at lower elevations, but hasn't been looked at.
You
right, Esteban? Nobody's...
No,
yeah.
But yeah, you'd expect that.
Yeah, yeah.
Particularly if they have been there for 10,000 years.
Right.
That's enough time.
To drive it.
We know that some of the polymorphisms in Europe are probably not that
even
old.
Less,
yeah
right.
You mentioned that maybe the lead problem.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe
oh, yeah.
Site.
Uh-huh.
So do you expect the same mutation?
It's a good question. What do I expect?
I mean,
potentially we would see less, maybe the global methylation might be a bit less. But the next sort of the next thing that we're working on is that we want to look at gene-specific methylation patterns, and a hypothesis is that the genes involved in the hypoxic response wouldn't show increased methylation. Well, I don't know. Potentially have different methylation patterns because of altitude versus because of lead. But you know, I hesitate when I speak because I feel like with respect. You know, we were writing a graduate research grant for Einosh's work, and so many times we would say, the current understanding is this, this, and this with respect to epigenetics, because it's constantly evolving right now. So I say what I say with a little bit of hesitation, because I feel like it could change with advancing data. Yeah.
Like when I go to high altitude,
yeah.
The heart rate is super
your heart rate.
High,
yep.
So I don't know if that.
Your pulse rate does increase. Yes, it does. So that happens for us, but that's not one of the high altitude adaptive.
So
well, I mean, I guess you could
like
say. Yeah, and in fact, you, if depending on how long you're there, mm-hmm. you will acclimatize, and your heart rate will go back to.
Yeah, you go slowly.
Mm-hmm. And you're right, and your hemoglobin production increases, and it takes about two weeks though to acclimatize.
Yeah.
About 2 weeks, and some people never really do.
I have a silly question related to that. So you have these different groups. We have people who are born at altitude coming
yep.
down. People who are from high altitude born there.
Yep.
Is there a big enough sample to look at people who are born at low altitude?
That is the you hit yes, no. That is the one big missing piece of this whole entire study design. It's the one population that is so difficult to recruit because they don't really. I mean. I don't want to say.
Us, though? Like
well, right, but I well, so that we have in different studies. So some of the work I did as a PhD student involved European women who lived in La Paz.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
The way the geopolitical structure of Peru and Bolivia are is that you don't have a lot of people. Ideally, we would want a Native American, an indigenous American group that up-migrated.
Yeah.
But because Lima is the capital of Peru and it's at sea level, and even though La Paz is the capital of Bolivia, Santa Cruz is really the economic center. So there's not a lot of up-migrants that are being drawn to an urban center. But I think with a lot of hard work, and probably a lot more time, like years, you could potentially recruit people from across the Altiplano. You'd have to be moving, because it's not like a center of migration.
But maybe like we were talking about before, maybe since with climate change and agriculture shifting higher and higher,
potentially,
maybe we will have seen
yeah,
more people
yeah,
at high altitudes.
Right,
before,
right.
So.
Not moving to urban centers, but moving over on the agricultural spectrum.
Yeah,
yeah that's true. That's true. It's a possibility. Yeah, that's it's interesting that you said that, because that's one of the critiques.
Yeah, I think the example that you gave of these genes that shows signatures of selection in two different populations,
mm-hmm.
and now you know the polymorphisms
right.
that are involved, is really one of the very few examples, I think, of convergent evolution.
Yeah,
that we
have. Yeah.
I mean, there's one for pigmentation in the
OCA2
gene. But you know, there are very few cases where you can really say that the same gene has been basically selected
uh-huh.
or under selection, but in different ways in two populations.
Yeah.
And the question is, Have you been able to, just with your selection data, to try to figure out dates? To date?
I haven't dated anything, but I need to. Yeah, and I need, yeah.
If one is older than
absolutely. So one of the things that's in the pipeline is that we're going to target next-gen sequence Eglin-1 and the Andeans, because I don't think it's necessarily this particular SNP. It's just a SNP that's tagging potentially the functional SNP.
Yeah.
And once we have those data, then my plan is to look at timing. Estimates.
In your original standard sequencing, you missed some of the variation, no? You missed some of the polymorphisms that were there, or?
Well, so we didn't target any of the intronic regions. It was just exons with, a little bit upstream and downstream, and then the UTRs. Which is why I then turned to the publicly available data. Because no introns were in there.
Okay.
Mostly cost.
Yeah, yeah.
The other thing is Eglin-1 is a region of high GC content. It's really hard to break into.
Yeah.
But I'm optimistic that we'll be able to get all of that data from
another
the.
Another question that I have is that you show four genes in Tibetans, four genes in Andeans, and then one in the middle,
What about those others? Yeah, exactly. What about the other four, I should go out here, let me just go. So NOS2A, there's some interesting ones in there. Sorry. So EPAS1 is that Tibetan gene that is the Denisovan one.
Yeah.
Yes, exactly.
That's
Endothelin-1, erythropoietin. So these two are involved in hemoglobin production, basically. This is terrible, but I can't remember what CASR does right now. But it's a HIF pathway gene. I don't know. It's in the cascade, but what exactly its role is in oxygen sensing right now is totally escaping me. Interestingly, PRKAA1, we published a paper maybe 3 years ago now with data on birth. I was talking a bit about the birth weight decline at altitude. And PRKAA1, in fact, SNPs in this gene associate with uterine artery diameter and birth weight among a Bolivian reproductive cohort that Lorna Moore recruited and that I worked with for my dissertation. We have, and then NOS2A, we also have, which is nitric oxide synthase 2. And one of the data phenotypes that I didn't mention is that we also, and I didn't talk about it at all anywhere, is exhaled nitric oxide. And nitric oxide is a byproduct, right, of essentially oxygen sensing. So Andeans, there's differences in Andean and Tibetan levels of exhaled nitric oxide, and NOS2A potentially could be involved in that, but we haven't explored that at all. But we have the phenotypic data to look at from the Andean cohort. And I also have low altitude exhaled nitric oxide levels for at sea level, which is we kind of wanted at altitude for Maya from Mexico too. So we have some comparison data to look at. So there's some interesting things in this Venn diagram that are.
You have not been testing polymorphisms.
Well, PRKA1 we did. Yeah, I mean but NOS2A not yet.
Okay.
Not yet. But I want to. That's one of the things I want to explore with the data set we have is associations with nitric oxide. There's some. Yeah, there's definitely some interesting things in there. Go ahead.
Where do you think the Simian Plateau will fit?
The Simian Plateau, if you look at the genomic papers that have come out, they're identifying genes in the HIF pathway that are different than actually any of these. Eglin-1 is not one that shows up. I went to a poster several years ago at a conference, and they were seeing an effect of Eglin-1 polymorphism on hemoglobin, but it didn't show a signature of selection. So it looked like it affected phenotype, but it wasn't selected for in the Ethiopians, which I thought was an interesting combination.
One thing that I find interesting is that when you were describing the three areas
uh-huh.
and the dates of
yeah.
that in fact in Ethiopia it seems to be the younger.
Yeah,
no?
I know.
So don't you, it's a little bit counterintuitive.
It is counterintuitive, exactly.
Yeah.
It is.
One more question and the final one for me.
Okay.
Can you tell us more about your functional studies that they're doing in, I mean, you're doing in collaboration with this researcher with mice?
No? Yeah. So all the mouse work so far has been, I have like extra slides down there. Just pull this up. So this is the only thing I mentioned about it, right, was the looking forward. So the Tibetan work is with mouse models. But when with the funding that we have to look at polymorphisms in Eglin-1 for Andeans is actually is not to introduce it into a mouse at this point in time. What we're going to do, the CRISPR work, to take the putative functional allele in Andeans, introduce it into the segment and see if it actually influences expression of Eglin-1. Mm-hmm. So it's going to be expression-based at this point in time. And then immunoprecipitation just to see if it actually has an effect on the protein structure, but without, in fact, creating a mouse model to see how it responds. We're not there yet.
There would be different possibilities also studying the phenotype.
And the other thing, too.
Because you say that some of the markers could be related to lung.
Yeah, right. Yeah. And I have another, I didn't mention it here, and I have a, there's a, at University of Michigan, I have an outstanding collaboration with, Dr. Anthony Antonellis, who actually has worked on Charcot-Marie-Tooth syndrome for his career mostly, but he does a lot of zebrafish knock-ins. So I've been talking to him a little bit about, particularly if we identify polymorphism genes outside of Eglin-1 that are outside of the expertise of my collaborator at UPenn, of looking at some things in some zebrafish models, because he's saying that vasculature in the zebrafish basically, like it's one of the best systems to look at changes in for zebrafish because it's easy to identify when in the different colonies. But they're just like seedlings of potential, but they haven't come to fruition yet.
Any other questions or
thanks?
Thanks again.
Thank you.